some comment about the chemical potential. So let me do a few comments just to get a bit more used to it. So yesterday we saw that the chemical potential appears in the both in the Bose and the Fermi distribution, and you should think about it given this formula. So the chemical potential tells you the rate of change of the entropy as I change the number of particles. So in the if you think about it, so so let's start with this definition. So you remember that the fact that this definition is related to the fact that if I take two subsystems and there is exchange of energy between these two systems, imagine that there is some separation to keep the same number of particles, but there is energy exchange, of course the two systems will reach the same temperature. And the reason is that given this definition, if they have different temperature, it means that the flow of energy from one side to the other would increase the entropy. Okay, so the only way to be in a stable situation is that they have the same temperature. Otherwise, a flow of energy would increase the total energy of the system. Similarly, the same thing happens for the chemical potential. For example, what we will see is that if I have a given reaction which exchange particle 1 and 2 to become 3 and 4, then if this reaction is in equilibrium, we will see that this equation holds. So the species will have a chemical potential to satisfy this equation, which makes sense because, again, if this is not satisfied, it means that either going in this direction, so changing particle 1 and 2 into 3, 4, or vice versa, it will be a way to increase the entropy. Okay? So to satisfy this relation is the same as is the analog of being in thermal equilibrium. Okay? Having the same temperature means that there is no advantage from the entropy point of view to move energy from one system to the other. In the same way, satisfying this relation means that there is no advantage in converting particles from one side to the other or vice versa. So for example, we're going to derive also this equation, but for example, this has some consequence. Imagine, for example, that there is some reaction, for example, E minus gamma into E minus gamma gamma. So imagine that you are in a phase of the universe in which the emission of one photon, so this kind of reaction in which a photon scattered with an electron emitting an extra photon, imagine that this reaction is fast enough to be in equilibrium. So this means that if you look at this equation, I mean, which of course can be generalized to many species, it implies that mu of gamma is equal to zero. Okay, because if this reaction is fast, it means that the system can change the number of photons in your thermal path. Okay, but then if this is in equilibrium, it means that this process creating or destroying a photon cannot change the entropy. I mean, the entropy must be an extremum. That is to say, this derivative must be zero, which implies that the chemical potential must be zero. Okay. So this happened many times. In a sense, of course, you always have to check which this is something that we are going to discuss. You always have to check which reactions are fast enough to be in equilibrium. But for example, if emission of photons is in equilibrium, then it means that the chemical potential of photons is zero. This also implies that if I take two species, let me call it A plus and A minus, you destroyed everything. I know that it's kind of amazing, but not so much. So if there is a particle and its antiparticle which annihilates in gamma, and again, if this reaction is fast enough to be in equilibrium so that I can apply thermodynamics, this equation tells you that the chemical potential of A must be the opposite of A minus. So in general, a particle and its own antiparticle, they will have the opposite chemical potential, provided that this reaction is fast enough to keep this in equilibrium.
What does it mean by a negative chemical potential?
This, in a sense,
by losing particles represent
something. Yes. So it's not obvious that this object is. I mean, of course, when you destroy A plus, for example. It means that at the same time you are destroying A minus and creating two gammas. So it's not obvious that this is always positive like this. Okay. So there is no guarantee that this is positive definite. In general, as I was discussing yesterday, so look again at the derivation we did yesterday, and. You remember, at a certain point, we were taking the entropy of the system and we were trying to maximize it as a function of the occupation number. Now, instead of thinking about, now we did it for a particular particle, but now instead of a particular part, a single species, let's consider, for example, many species, like, for example, old quarks or leptons, okay, so a collection of particles. Now, if you remember the derivation, I mean, I didn't specify actually that it was really a single particle. I mean, the fact of being one quark or another is like an internal number, okay? So you can go through the derivation and think about all these states, okay? I was talking about all these energy eigenstates. And being a particular quark or another may be another label of these states. Okay. So now you remember, I have to maximize the entropy and I have to impose some condition, what is conserved. And what is conserved will be, well, for sure, there will be the energy. But if reactions of this kind any reaction is active, it means that there will be some conserved quantity. For example, let me write this. For example, I'm writing something like a baryon number. What I'm doing here is exactly what we did yesterday, but with the difference that instead of keeping constant the number of particles of a given species, I'm imposing the conserved quantities that I want to impose, which of course will depend on what is my microphysics. For example, in the standard model, the baryon number will be conserved, okay? So I will have to impose that the sum over all the species of you remember, this is the number of states, the occupation fraction, okay, times the baryon quantum number, okay, which would be positive for baryons and negative for anti-baryons, and I want this object to remain constant, because it's not true that in my box the number of a given species is constant. What is concerned is the total number of baryons, and I will have here I'm imposing only one conservation in particular, but imagine that I want also to impose lepton number, so there will be another expression like this, okay? And you remember that this alpha is basically the chemical potential, apart from T. So the bottom line is that I will have a chemical potential for each conserved quantity, okay? So you remember that this Lagrange multiplier appears in the distribution, and instead of having one for each species, I will have one for each conserved quantity. Okay? So I will have a chemical potential, for example, for the baryon number, one for the lepton number, and then it depends on your theory. It depends both on your theory, which are the conserved quantities, and also in the regime you're interested in, because you may be in a regime in which I don't know, for example, even the number of, it depends on which reaction is fast and which one is slow. Okay, any question? So I just wanted to say that you should not think too much about one chemical potential for each species, but you should think about one chemical potential for each conserved quantity in your system. So, eventually, and this, if you want, explains also why a particle and its antiparticle, they have opposite chemical potential, because particle and antiparticle will have opposite quantum numbers, so they will always appear with opposite sign this, so that they will have opposite chemical potential. Okay. So here, this expression is telling you that the number of A plus and the number of A minus is not separately conserved, but there is some, at least in this reaction, there is a conserved quantity, which is the A A number, which is the difference between, in which this is counted with the plus sign and this with the minus sign. That's why there is an opposite chemical potential. In general, it may be complicated in the sense at each moment you have some reaction which is at equilibrium, which will impose some relation in your thermal bath, and you have to solve for all the chemical potentials. Okay.
That expression is something?
Which one?
That expression, entropy.
Yeah, so no, this I was just repeating what we saw yesterday. So yesterday, at a certain point, to derive this was a step to derive the Bose-Einstein and Fermi-Dirac distributions. Okay, so this is just this equation is just the statement that the entropy must be maximized. It must be an extremum with respect to Ni with these conserved quantities. Okay, so it was just a step of the derivation, with the only difference that now, instead of having constant number of particles, I have some conserved quantity which relates different species. Mm-hmm. So the bottom line, if you do the same thing that we did yesterday, of course you end up in a thing like this. The distribution at the end will be for a given species J, so for a given species of particle, sorry, maybe it's a bit misleading because this index looks a bit like this, let me call it big A. So if I choose a given particle, okay, a given particle will have a certain quantum number. For example, let's focus on the baryon quantum number. Okay, so this particle has a certain baryon number, which may be positive or negative. Okay, since it appears in this expression, it appears also in the distribution function. Okay, and you see that baryons and antibaryons will have opposite contribution in the statistical distribution. If I have more quantum numbers, I will have an expression which contains many chemical potentials.
So you can say that the at equilibrium, the number of particles, antiparticles, I mean, is more likely to have more number of particles than antiparticles.
Why?
Because the expression is, I mean, mu is positive, then the thing is...
Yeah, but it's completely symmetric, so mu can be positive or negative. Okay, in this sense, everything is symmetric between particles and antiparticles until I specify the sign of mu.
I mean, and we don't define like mu particles to be positive, no?
Well, but of course, until I put some asymmetry by hand, particles and antiparticles are exactly on the same foot. What I call particle and antiparticle is completely. So, if you want, is the fact that the sign of mu, once I choose a certain sign, this is what I call particles the one that in the universe are more present. But it's just a posteriori choice, no?
Okay.
So everything is to create some asymmetry between, for example, baryons and antibaryons, I have to choose mu, and this will create an asymmetry between the two. If mu is equal to zero, it's completely symmetric.
Mm-hmm.
But there is no direction, no? In this sense, it's by hand. Okay. So we are going to come back. This. Any question before I raise
them? How do you normally compute the chemical potential? How do you get expression for the chemical potential?
Well, it depends. it depends what you're given. So. For example, imagine that I give you. You can think about the chemical potential. So the answer is similar to the question: how do I calculate the temperature of the system? Okay. So in some sense, it's something given. Okay. Mm-hmm. It's very analog to this. You can also say the following. So imagine that I tell you that I have a system in which baryon number is conserved. I give you what is the baryon number at the beginning. Then I will choose mu in such a way that the total number of baryons does not change. Okay. So in the system. So if you want, there is this unknown quantity in the distribution function must be such that the total number of baryons is the one I want. So it's if I tell you in this box. I want a certain number of baryons, then you have to choose mu in the distribution in such a way that it gives this number of baryons. So it's one-to-one with the numbers of the conserved quantity that I choose. Of course, if these quantities are always conserved, this is something that I have to fix at the beginning. Now, you may think that there is some mechanism which violates baryon numbers and generates this dynamically, then it's another point. But in the limit in which it is conserved, it is something that I have to fix, and this fixes the value of the chemical potential. Okay, so yesterday we saw the derivation of these distributions. Now let's apply to the universe. So, as I was discussing yesterday, for the time being, we are going to assume that there is thermal equilibrium. More specifically, what do we mean? Well, I mean that that a given process will have a certain rate. Okay. For example, I don't know, the process I was talking about before, this process. Okay. This is a process which changes the number of photons in the universe. Actually, this is a good example, because this is a process which, at a certain point, very late in the universe, becomes inefficient. So, at the beginning, meaning early on, the rate for this process is much larger than Hubble, so that what I was saying before is correct. At a certain point, very late, this process will become inefficient. That is to say that at a certain point this rate will be much smaller than Hubble. Okay. So this is what I called equilibrium. So a process is in equilibrium when its rate is much larger than Hubble. Okay. And you should think about it really like in thermodynamics. Okay. So you have a box. I'm changing the size of this box because the universe is expanding. What I'm asking is whether this expansion is very slow compared to the processes inside the box. If this happens, basically I have an adiabatic slow changes, but the process is fast enough to adjust, so I remain in thermal equilibrium. If, on the other hand, I am in the opposite situation, it means that I'm changing the size of the box and there is no time to adjust. Okay? So the typical, so I will start I mean, this you should do this for any process you're interested in. Okay. In general, okay, of course, one start assuming thermal equilibrium and then see what happens when this approximation does not hold anymore. So we're going to start with this approximation and then we're going to see when it fails. Okay. Let me. This is something that we're going to discuss. Let me do another example, which will become relevant in a second. So think about any process which has to do with weak interactions. Okay, for example, I don't know, some scattering rate of neutrinos on the other particles. Okay, so any weak process at low energy will be described by some rate which is proportional to G Fermi squared. Okay. And just by dimensional analysis, okay, I'm talking about neutrinos, let's imagine that I am at quite high temperature, so I can neglect the mass of neutrinos, even the mass of the electrons, okay? So I will have a rate of interactions which by dimensional analysis goes like this. Okay, this has dimension minus 4, so to make an object with dimension 1, I have to put t to the 5. Okay. Just to be concrete, let's think about the interaction of neutrinos, for example, scattering with electrons, for example. Now, I have to compare with H. Well, H, I know that H squared is something proportional to the energy density. I also tell you that I'm interested in this process in radiation dominance. Okay, so rho is the energy of radiation. Again, just by dimensional analysis, goes like t to the fourth. Mm-hmm. Okay. So H goes like t squared. So you see that this process is in equilibrium at high temperature, because, okay, now we can look for when it happens, but for sufficiently high temperature, this is much larger than this. At a certain point, these two become equal, and I go to the opposite regime. Okay, so this is just to make an example of a process which is in thermal equilibrium, and then stop to be in thermal equilibrium. I mean, there is no rule, but this usually it is the case. So you should think about a situation in which early on processes are in equilibrium, and then the universe dilutes and processes become slower than the upper rate. It's not a rule, but it's true for many examples. Okay, let's assume to be this situation and study a bit of thermodynamics. So imagine that I have a box. Let me explain what I want to do. Yesterday we saw the Fermi and Bose distribution. This tells me the occupation rate of states. Okay. Of course, now I want to use this distribution to calculate the energy density, the pressure, the number density. Okay. So to do this step, I also must know what are the states, because I know what is the fraction of states which are filled and empty, but I have to also to specify what are these states. Okay. And I'm interested in a situation in which I have, for example, let me think about a box. So I want to put particles in this box. So I want to calculate what are the density of these states, so that I can calculate, for example, the total energy of the system. Okay. So if I put a particle in this box, I will have, let's assume that I put some boundary condition, for example, periodic boundary conditions. So the wave functions will be quantized in this way. So I put back h bar. So this is the wave function describing free propagation in this box. If I impose a boundary condition, let me assume that the side of the box is L. I want that this wave function is periodic, so px times L over h bar must be a multiple, an integer number. Okay. So this means that I want to count the number of states that I have. So the possible states are labeled by these integers. And in particular, the number of states per so the number of states in a given volume in momentum space is given by the cube of this, n cube over 2 pi cube. Okay, so this is the number of possible states in a unit volume in momentum space. Okay, so I'm just saying that basically the momentum is quantized in this way. If I want the number of states per unit volume in momentum space and unit volume also in real space, I have to divide by the volume, which is this. Okay. I can also put h bar, so I reintroduced h bar, but usually we take h bar equal to 1, so I just have this factor. So this factor just tells me that the number of free particle states in a given per unit volume and unit volume in momentum space is just this dimensionless number. Okay. So just to be concrete now, first of all, let me add another something obvious. So let me put a G here. So of course, there are some internal states of a particle that usually we don't count. We didn't explicitly take into account. But of course, if I tell you that there are two spin states, of course, the number of states has to count the possibility of the two spins. So all internal degrees of freedom, notice that sometimes it's the color, sometimes, so you have to count all the internal degrees of freedom. Okay, there are additional, an additional factor here. So this expression allows me to calculate something easy. For example, imagine that I want to know what is the total energy. Let me go here. Okay. I have a particle inside this box following either the Fermi or the Bose distribution, and I want to calculate the total energy inside this box. Okay. What do I do? Well, I have to integrate over, let me calculate the energy per volume, okay? Because I usually am interested in the energy density, so the energy in a given volume. What I have to do, I have to integrate over momenta, okay? Because I want to keep 1 over volume. So this is the integral in d3p. So these are all the possible state of momentum divided by this quantity. So this is counting the number of states. Then there is the filling fraction, okay? The fraction of states which are filled or empty, which is exactly what we calculated yesterday. Okay, so it's the 1 over, okay, let me, sorry, I forget, but here I'm just counting the states and the filling fraction, but I want to calculate the energy, so I have to put the energy here, which is the square root of m squared plus d squared, or e, whatever. Okay. And the same will be true for any quantity. For example, if I want to calculate the number of particles, the total number of particles, again, the total number of particles per volume, what I do the same thing. I integrate over all possible states with the correct weight, and then I just counting, so I don't have the energy now, so I just put my distribution. Okay? And so on and so forth. So any thermodynamical quantity can be calculated just summing over all possible states times the filling fraction that we calculated yesterday. Yeah, this is rho, energy density. This sometimes is called small n, so it is the density of particles per unit volume. So you see that given your particle, it's either a boson or a fermion, given the temperature and if there is a chemical potential, I can calculate all the thermodynamical quantities. Okay, there is a quantity which is, let me do this exercise. Okay, before getting to that, I just want to mention that a good reference for this kind of calculation, and in general for good notes in cosmology, are the notes by Daniel Bauman. You can find them on his website. Well, it contains much more than what we need, but it's a nice modern set of lectures about cosmology. So in particular, this part there is a chapter which is called, I guess, Thermodynamics of the Early Universe, which goes through this kind of calculation. I was saying that another quantity that I would like to calculate is the pressure. The pressure is not so obviously related to this, so it's not completely obvious how to calculate the pressure out of this sum over states. So let me go through it in some detail. So I already tell you what is the answer, then I can derive it. So the pressure can be written in a similar way as a sum over all possible states. Yeah, what is not obvious is the what is here is p squared over 3e. Okay. Well, this answer makes okay, now we're going to verify it, but it makes some sense because you already know that in the case of relativistic particles, okay, so if I'm talking about particle, for example, massless particles, the pressure is equal to the energy density, so this becomes energy over 3, which is the same as this calculation, apart from a factor of 3. So this is consistent with the fact that the pressure is rho over 3. Sorry, notice that I'm using capital P and small p. So small p is the momentum of the particle, and capital P is the pressure.
How do you get the 3e?
I'm going to derive it. No, yeah, good. No, in fact, so this is not obvious how to write this. I'm just saying that now I'm going to derive it, but just as a check, it reproduces the fact that for a relativistic species, the pressure is rho over 3 because this is energy over 3. Okay, let's now verify this. So what I'm going to do is very straightforward, is just to look at a piece of the surface of our box. So I'm going to do a statistical mechanics kind of calculation, in the sense I look at a small part of the area of the box, and I'm going to look at particles which are bouncing on the wall, exchanging, of course, some momentum. Okay, so I'm going to really to calculate the force exerted by these particles on a given piece of surface. Okay, so in principle, everything is well defined. So I just have to sit down and calculate, because I know the filling fraction of all possible states of my system. So I just have to calculate the rate of bouncing and therefore the force exerted on the wall. Okay, so I take a piece of surface with area dA with versor orthogonal n, and so there will be some particles. This is infinitesimal, so it should be small. And there will be some particles in some direction. First of all, let's count how many particles there are in a given volume. So this volume subtend a solid angle d omega. So I am here, and I'm looking at all possible orientations. So in particular, there is a small set of particles subtending a solid angle d omega with respect to my surface, and with a certain radius. And of course, the number of particles, n, is the usual factor, g over 2 pi cube. Let me explain, one thing. I want to deduce this factor. So You see, this is something that will be integrated over momenta. Okay. So basically, I'm assuming that these particles, they have a given momentum. Okay. Then I will integrate over it. So this number is actually number of particles per volume in momentum, because this is something that I will integrate over. Okay. So it's g over 2 pi cube coming from that. But I have to integrate over the volume now. And the volume is the filling fraction f. I mean, the filling fraction is always this distribution function. And then there is r squared. Of course, so these particles will bounce on my surface. They will bounce it in a given fraction of time, which I call dt. And since they have velocity v, I told you that I'm going to specify the momentum, that is to say the velocity. So the this size is v dt. So I get modulus v dt times d omega. Okay, so this is the volume of this particular slab. Okay, so it's the radius squared times v dt, which is this, and d omega is the solid angle I observe. But this is not over, because here I'm counting all the particles with a given velocity v, but not all of them will bounce on the a. Okay, so they have a certain velocity, but some of them are going in another direction. So the fraction of particles which will bounce on the surface, which I call dNa, is dN, all the particles inside here, times dA over 4 pi r squared. So this is I have to calculate what is the fraction of solid angle that the area, this area, subtend compared to 4 pi. So it's dA over the full sphere, but I have to be careful that there is an angle, because this is not perpendicular to this. So there is an angle, and this angle is v dot m over b, like the modulus of b. Sorry, I'm a bit quick, but these are quite straightforward calculations. I'm just saying that I have to be careful that this ratio is just if the surface is perpendicular to this volume element. If it is not perpendicular, there is an angle which can be expressed in this way. Okay? So this is the number of particles. Now let me put this expression back. Yes, and I get this. Okay, did I do it correctly? Yes, so r squared cancel, I'm left with this 4 pi. So there is dA, dt, d omega. Okay, this v goes away with this, there is v dot m, and then there is the distribution. Okay, so we're almost done. Now, so this is the number of particles bouncing on A. Okay, of course. We go here. So now, at the end, I want to calculate the force exerted on the wall. Okay. Yes. So I So I have the number of particles bouncing on the wall. I'm interested in the number of particles per unit time and unit area. Okay, because I want to calculate the momentum per unit time per unit area, which is the pressure. What is the momentum that they exchange with the wall is P dotted into N, so the momentum perpendicular to the surface. There is a factor of 2, because of course there are, I mean, if the bounce is elastic, they will flip the sign of the momentum perpendicular to the wall, so there is a factor of 2. That's it, so I have to integrate this over the possible orientation. Okay, so I'm taking a given momentum P, that is a given modulus of the momentum, but I have to integrate over all the possible directions of this calculation. Yes, so I put this expression here. So I just copied this, I put it here, and now you see where this factor of 3 comes from. Okay, it comes from the fact that I'm doing this average. So this basically is an average over the solid angle. Actually, it's an average over half solid angle, because of course I'm going to sum, since this is the wall, I'm going to sum over all possible directions on this side of the wall. So it's half of omega. But this half goes away with these 2. And this is the average of basically some cosine squared, which gives 1/3. Okay. So this, well, the velocity, this becomes 1/3. You can write it as, so the velocity v is p over e. In modulus, so this is just p squared over e. This 1/3 comes from the fact that averaging over the solid angle, so it's like averaging the projection over, say, the z-axis, which gives 1/3 in 3 dimension, and you see that you get exactly the expression here. Okay. You get 1/3 p squared over e times the usual factor which appears here. The last thing is that I'm going to add to sum over all possible momenta, because here I assumed a particular direction. Anyway, this was just, the details are not so important, but I just want to make an example of every quantity you can ask to this problem, since you have the filling fraction of all possible states is something that you just have to sit down and calculate. Okay. So any question? This was a bit quick, but I don't think it's so important. What is more interesting is, now let's focus on this calculation, because this is what enters the Friedmann equation. Okay. So rho is what enters in the Friedmann equation. Can I erase this? Okay, let me do the following. So let's look at this expression. And let me assume that mu is equal to zero. Okay. So this means that I'm talking about some particle which has no conserved quantum number. Okay. So a particle which can annihilate with, imagine that I have some particle, there is no asymmetry, okay, I have the same number of particles and antiparticles, okay, so that mu is equal to zero. Okay, it's not true in for any species, but it's an assumption. Now, you already see from this expression something which is the most important feature. So since E is equal to square root of m squared plus p squared, we already see that there is a big difference. So if the temperature is much bigger than the mass, or the temperature is much smaller than the mass. Okay, let's consider the two limits. But we already sort of know the answer. If the temperature is much bigger than the mass, I can even set the mass equal to zero. And there is no, I mean, everything, the only dimensionful quantity is the temperature. So apart from the prefactors that I will calculate, I already know that this object goes like t to the fourth, because this is the only quantity there. On the other hand, if the temperature is much smaller than the mass, then you see that there is some exponential suppression, okay, because e to the m over t is exponentially small, okay, so when it goes to numerator is the usual Boltzmann suppression. Okay. So in first approximation, this tells you that at a given temperature, the first question that you want to know is which particles belong to this and which belong to that, because the one that belongs to this, they already disappeared from your thermal bath. They are too heavy to be produced, they are exponentially suppressed, unless there is some conserved quantity that prevents their disappearance. The ones which are in this approximation, basically you can treat them as massless, and they are abundant in your plasma, and they contribute to the energy density. Yes, so, I mean, the calculation is straightforward, so what is rho? Let me write it. So it's an integral over momentum plus or minus one. I just rewrote what is there. Let me introduce two dimensionless quantity x and xi. Yes. So rho can also be written as g over 2 pi squared times t to the fourth times e plus or minus of psi. So what I did is just to say, okay, let me, so this has dimension 4, so let me pull out t to the 4. Then the remaining thing is a dimensionless number, which just depends on psi, the ratio between the mass and the temperature. As I was saying, so there is the limit psi going to zero, and in this case I'm interested in e plus or minus of zero, which is just a simple integral. I mean, it's just I took the case basically mass equal to zero, I'm left with this integral. This integral is a number, and this number is this number for bosons, mm-hmm, which I called E minus of 0. While in the case of fermions, you get 7 over 8 times the number 4 bosons. Okay. So there's no surprise, okay, so the calculations are straightforward. There's no surprise in the sense I told you that for zero mass or negligible mass, the result must be proportional to T to the fourth. There is some prefactors that, of course, it's important to remember, but it's sort of straightforward. Notice also that we are in a regime, of course, in which the difference between bosons and fermions makes some difference, because we are in a situation in which the mass is negligible, so some of the states are completely full, and then it makes some difference. I mean, not a very important difference, but some difference that we are talking about bosons and fermions. This number, of course, is smaller for fermions because, for a given temperature, the filling fraction is surely smaller. So bosons likes to be there, while fermions do not. So it makes sense that for a given temperature, fermions contribute a bit less to the energy density, because it's more difficult to put fermions in your physical system. Okay, but apart from this, so remember this 7 over 8 because it will come many times. But for the rest, the result is just something scaling like T to the fourth. In the opposite limit, that is to say, when the mass is bigger than the temperature, well, the calculation is always that one, but I can do the approximation psi much bigger than 1. Any question? Ask me. Please. Okay, so it's the same calculation over there. In this limit, I can pull out. let me write. So as a function of psi, this integral is equal to there is an integral between 0 and plus infinity in the x of I'm just rewriting the same integral but using these variables x and psi. I didn't do this approximation yet, okay? But you see that if psi is much larger than 1, this is a large number, okay? So of course, this will kill the distribution function, and this is already exponentially suppressed. So of course, x wants to be as small as possible, because it is already exponentially suppressed, so you don't want to pay extra x squared. So you can expand for small x this expression, and it becomes like this. Here you can just forget about x, so you have x squared times I, and here you have you expand this exponent. You can also forget about plus or minus 1. And this is important because it tells you that we are in a regime in which, since everything is exponentially suppressed, there is no difference between bosons and fermions, because it's important. The difference is important when two particles found themselves in the same state, because in the case of fermions they cannot. But here everything is so dilute that the difference between fermions and bosons is irrelevant, and you see it from the fact that. Anyway, this plus or minus 1 is small compared to into the xi, which is large. Okay, so I can forget about this difference. And I can also expand this, which is into the xi plus 1 half x squared over 2 xi. I just expanded this. But notice, this is just the non-relativistic expression of the energy. In a sense, this is the mass over t. And this is the kinetic energy, which is p squared over m over 2 over t, because x has also t. So this is the usual Boltzmann suppression. So you can write it also as so e to the minus xi is in front of everything. It's just e to the minus m over t. Then there is xi outside, and then there is the integral in dx, x squared, e to the minus x squared over 2 xi. So if you want to make it more transparent, we can go back to the original. So this is just p squared over 2m all divided by t. It's just the kinetic energy in the Boltzmann factor. So this is the usual Boltzmann non-relativistic limit. So here you can write p squared over t cube. Okay. Anyway, it's not so relevant, this calculation, apart from the fact that you have to remember that everything is exponentially suppressed. So you can check that the precise number is okay, so this is the ratio of E plus or minus as a function of psi for large psi. Well, plus or minus does not matter for the reason I explained. And what is important is that compared with this number is something which is exponentially suppressed. Okay. So, what is the bottom line? The bottom line is that at a given temperature, unless there are conserved quantities which change the picture, but if you forget about conserved quantities, let it be concrete. Let's think about, for example, the standard model. Okay, so imagine that I am at a certain temperature. I am at 1 GeV. Okay, so the top quark is very heavy compared to 1 GeV. So it is, since there is no top and anti-top will disappear from the plasma, okay, because there is no conserved top number. So they disappear from the plasma and they give a completely negligible contribution to the energy density. On the other hand, the up quark, for example, is still very light, and it's so light that its mass can be neglected, and I can just use this result. Okay? So this result allows me to define the following thing. Okay. So what did they do? Well, first of all, I use this this expression. There is also a 2 pi squared here. So the contribution of a single boson to this is pi squared over 30. Okay, so this is a contribution t to the 4. So this is the contribution of a single boson. This object, g star, is basically the number of relativistic degrees of freedom. So it counts how many bosons you have in your system. What does it mean? It means the bosons which are light compared to your temperature, because the ones that are heavy, they are exponentially suppressed. So when people say what is the number of relativistic degrees of freedom, it means the ones which are light compared to your temperature, with the trick that both the fermions are counted in the same way, but taking into account this prefactor 7 over 8. Okay? So instead of separating fermions from bosons, I just use the trick that one fermion count 7 over 8 compared to a bosons, just because when I do this integral, I get a slightly different prefactor. Okay? And this number is conventionally called G star. Notice that it's not a constant number. It changes as a function of the temperature, because as the temperature goes down, some of the particles become heavy and they become exponentially suppressed. Okay, now somebody comes. I think it's your turn. It's your turn. I think you are an expert of this.
No.
No, but it's lovely to come. You just let it come. Please, it's your turn.
I understand.
So, just to, as a final exercise for today, I want to, and everybody can help from the seat. So let's calculate this number in the case of the standard model. So let me, what should I erase? First of all, let me erase all this. So the game is the following. Let's assume that I look at the universe at a temperature which is, 500 GeV. Okay? In such a way that all standard model particles can be considered approximately as massless. Okay. So now we have to calculate G star. And I told you what are the rules. The rules is that each boson counts as 1, each fermion as 7 over 8. Okay. Be careful that, of course, there are a lot of internal, there is spin. So when I say one boson, it means one state. But of course, the two helicities count as 2. Then there are internal, blah, blah, blah. Okay. You have to count all, and then there are the three generations, and then Goran is there looking at you symbolically.
For all the star models.
Yes.
Okay, so we have.
Okay, let's. We start with fermion, for example.
Okay, we start with fermion. We have nu e and e just by 3 because it's.
All of them.
We just have the same, then we will have up to 4 and down to 4. Minus 3, right? 4 colors. This is
particles.
Particles
and particles.
Aren't particles also counted?
Hey, yeah, no, this is the okay. No, but think about it. No, they count because you know this is important. No, so if I am at a certain temperature, it means that there are the same number of down quarks and anti down quarks. So of course, also the antiparticles count. It also be careful also that. There are left and right.
Mm-hmm.
But the standard model is
left and right.
Okay, so there would be like up and down, and top bottom jump strange, and then there would be. Okay, there would be what?
Two helicities. No.
I guess.
Left handed is not in the double.
You're, from there you receive all possible words, left, right, up, column, right hand, left twice, twice. Yeah. What, three times, okay. Left handed, over seven.
We can always shoot to we get something. Right. Okay, there would be...
But electromagnetism is coupled also with the right hand.
Okay.
No, yeah, let's I mean, I'm not sure if you studied this already with Goran, but let's remember, why we multiply this... be careful because people must follow, so let's forget about this factor of 2.
Okay,
no, just to be clear what are these factors. So there is a factor of 3, which are just the generations, okay? So there are 3 generations for everything, so there is a 3 out of everything, so this we can cancel. There is a 3 which multiplies all this.
Okay.
Then there is this 3
color.
This is called color, and of course the color only count quarks, not the electrons. Okay. Now we must be careful about what happens to the weak interactions. In a sense, if you remember, okay, if you want, we are talking about left and right. Okay. Well, here there are apart from the fact that they have different representation under the weak interaction. There is you left, down left, you right, and down right.
Yes.
So, okay, so there is a factor of 2 here.
Mm-hmm. Right?
Mm-hmm. Here, if you remember, it's a bit asymmetric because there is only the singlet of the electron. Okay. So here I will put plus 1 if you want.
Okay.
Here. Okay. And then we have to count antiparticles. Okay, so everything, all these will be multiplied by 2. Okay, let's put the 2 in there.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
All right, this should be okay. I'm not sure. Now we'll check if I forget. Then, okay, these are fermions. So fermions are 7/8. Okay. Then, we have the bosons here.
Okay, we have the bosons. We have. We will consider all of them to be massless, right? Because of the limits.
Oh, yeah, so, no, this is part of the definition. In a sense, if I tell you to calculate G star at a given temperature, you only consider the ones which are lighter than this temperature.
Okay.
Of course, you know, if the temperature is very close to one of the mass, you are in a transition in which you should use the explicit formula. So it's not really true that you can neglect the one of the two, but let's assume that we are at a temperature much higher than...
Yeah, and the density of the up and down quark, I mean, 2 because of the density.
What is the density is this, no?
2 is because antiparticles.
These are particles, particle, okay. Antiparticle. This is 3 generations. this color. And this, if you want, is left-right. Okay. So, does somebody has a way to calculate the number? Okay, we can do it.
It's not that huge.
No, but, yeah.
Yeah, the minus Z.
The gluons.
Should we consider the gluons on Higgs as well?
Yes,
eggluons.
And Higgs.
The Higgs, okay.
Eggluons.
Oh, wait. Higgs is scalar. And we have this for this to be 2 for helicities. They are massless. 2. 2. That would be 8.
And Higgs. Why that 2? For W plus N?
For the
massless,
because it's massless. So we
oh, you're massless.
Okay. It's massless, it would be 3. And this for the Higgs, it would be
1. Polarization.
Yeah. So here you have to decide, but you must be consistent. So the part of the Higgs. So either you consider the full Higgs doublet.
Mm-hmm.
Or you put it in the W polarizations. So if you treat them as massless, mm-hmm. which is okay, so you can treat them as massless, but then all the states in the Higgs must be
before a spontaneous symmetry.
Yeah, if you want, you can.
Yeah.
It's okay.
No, no, I don't get it. No.
Yeah. So what I'm saying is that because I don't know if you studied. So the Higgs contains is a doublet of complex scalars. So these are four states. Now, three of these states becomes the longitudinal component of the W and the Z. Mm-hmm. But if you consider this as part of this, then each of these becomes three.
Okay.
And then it's one.
Okay.
The other possibility is that I count them as massless, but then there are four states for the Higgs.
Okay.
So one of the two, but this is cancelled.
And those are all bosons? You don't have any?
Yes. Okay, let's put equal to. Can somebody calculate this? Yeah, come on, you are technological. Okay.
We have 315
by 4.
That's 80.
Yeah,
I can see.
Yeah, I can see.
I can see.
395 by 4. Over 4. That's almost 100.
Approximately
100. No, then it's not correct. This could
sorry. Are we missing the polarization of the bosons?
Yes.
Thanks. Yeah. You see?
Okay.
Put the polarization. Thanks. Okay, so we go back. Thanks.
Then the structure. This 16, 17, 20, 23,
26, 28. Better.
Okay, 28.
Yes, yes.
100.
Yeah, but can somebody, Andrew, is it 28 plus 21 times 16 over 4?
That's 315.
Yeah, but just
315, but 20 times 15 is 306.7.
Okay. No, it's just because I knew the number, so that's just to check it's correct then. It's 106.75. Okay. Yeah, it's I know. Do write it as like this. Anyway, what is important? This order is more than 100.
Okay.
And okay. So this, it's a number that it's important to remember. For reason, but maybe I will explain. So, but the picture is that so this G star changes. Thank you. This number changes quite a lot because okay, at very high temperature it's over 100. So, at a certain point, imagine that for example I am at temperature of order MeV, mega electron volt. Then there are not so many particles which are lighter than MeV. There will be electrons, neutrinos, the gammas. That's it, basically. Okay. So, and this number we're going to check, it becomes of order 10 at that point. So it changes quite substantially, and it's important because for a given temperature, this is what enters in the Friedmann equation, and this G star changes by an order of magnitude. Of course, This assuming that is the standard mode. Ah, okay, one note. Of course, we didn't put the graviton in the business. The reason why we didn't put the graviton is not that we screwed up, but you always remember what are the assumptions. The assumption here is that we are only counting the particles which are in thermal equilibrium. Okay. The graviton, you can check, but it depends on the assumption. But anyway, we are assuming that the graviton does not go in thermal equilibrium. Of course, the graviton is very weakly coupled, so unless something happens at very high energy, it's not in thermal equilibrium. So that's why the reason why we didn't count. We also didn't count other particles. For example, I don't know, maybe you already studied something about the possible existence of right-handed neutrinos. Well, the right-handed neutrinos, then one has to discuss whether they are there, whether they are too massive, whether the interaction are such that they enter in thermal equilibrium. But you start seeing that, you know, that this course becomes very similar to the one of Goran, in the sense that, depending on what are your assumptions about what the physics beyond the standard model, the calculations start becoming different. For example, if there is supersymmetry, it means that there are many more degrees of freedom at sufficiently high temperature. This number becomes a factor of two or more bigger, okay? And so on and so forth. Okay, let me stop here and continue on Friday.
I have a question.
Yeah.
What is the temperature difference of temperature dependence of G star? If it were low temperature, for example, say 100, we take 50 GeV or something.
50 GeV is not. Is the number of there is nothing deep in this formula, no? So this formula, the correct formula is you take all the particles and you sum over Fermi or Bose distribution. Okay.
Yes.
Now you can do it. On the other hand, for every particle which is much heavier than the temperature,
yes,
I get something which is exponentially suppressed.
Okay.
So the approximation is that let's forget about all the particles which are heavier than your 50 GeV or whatever.
Yes.
Okay, let's forget about them. You can, of course, if somebody is close to this temperature, maybe I want to check that that the exponential is sufficiently suppressed. But in first approximation, I just forget about all the particles which are heavier than this,
yeah,
and I just do the calculation he did only with the particles which are lighter than this. So it's just so. You can see it in, for example, in Daniel's notes. You see that this G star is decreases as the temperature drops because more and more particles disappear from the planet. So what happens physically? I mean, this particle will not. So what happens is that, for example, let's consider the bottom quarks. Okay, at temperature much higher than 5 GeV or whatever, the plasma, E plus E minus, produce, for example, B and B bar. Okay, so these particles are abundant in your plasma, like electrons. When the temperature drops, so bottom and anti-bottom annihilate, but since the typical energy of electrons start becoming lower than 5 GeV, it's very difficult to produce this bottom. So they just annihilate, depositing energy in the plasma, but they are not recreated anymore. So if you follow the bottom distribution, it becomes exponentially suppressed. Okay, so this is what happens. So more and more particles disappear from the plasma just because they are too heavy to be produced. Any other question? One, two, three. All right, I'll see you on Friday then.